Back to Sunday night now, and the quest for Reginald Goodall in Omnibus.
Omnibus tonight is about a great British musician, Reginald Goodall. He's 83 years old, and although he has rarely conducted abroad, his name is known around the world through his recordings and by word of mouth as one of the finest conductors of Wagner's operas.
But Reginald Goodall is something of a mystery. When we set out to make this program, I quickly realized that I virtually knew nothing about his career before 1968. In that year, he hit the musical headlines for the first time as the inspirer and conductor of an epoch-making production of The Master Singers by Wagner at Sadler's Wells, the old opera in Rosebery Avenue. And then he followed that up when the Wells was transformed into the English National Opera, doing the complete cycle of The Ring in English in the early 1970s. And it was unforgettable for those who were there. But I learnt later that already back in 1945, Reginald Goodall had conducted the world premiere of Britain's Peter Grimes. It was a huge success. Afterwards, he went to work at the new Covent Garden Opera Company. And the rest was virtually silence as far as the general opera-loving public was concerned. And this 20 years of obscurity and neglect between Grimes and Master Singers was apparently inexplicable. Certainly, I found it very hard to understand. But as I say, Reginald Goodall's life and career has been something of a mystery. He's a musician's musician, that was clear. Diffident and shy, he lives, it seems, entirely for music. He dislikes all kinds of personal publicity and fuss, and that included, to start with at any rate, this programme. We began it last January, when rehearsals were underway in Cardiff for the new Welsh National Opera production of The Walküre, which Reggie, as he's affectionately known, later conducted with huge ovations all over the country. Since then, he's made a new recording of Wagner's Parsifal, which is an enormous undertaking for any conductor. It's easy enough to document Reggie now, but what I've discovered is that there's absolutely nothing anywhere in any musical archive or photographic library or gramophone collection before Peter Grimes. And characteristically, Mr. Goodall has no personal photographs or documents to offer. Such things don't interest him. So you can begin to understand why we've called this program The Quest for Reginald Goodall. It may seem unbelievable that this frail little man can dominate the rampant forces of a mighty Wagnerian orchestra. But before this first full rehearsal, there have been separate rehearsals with each section of the orchestra, so already every player knows exactly what Reggie wants and is inspired to give it to him. Coming back to these Cardiff rehearsals from time to time to see Reginald Goodall at work today, and we shall be talking to him about his life in music. But the first part of our quest takes us to meet somebody who knew him over 50 years ago.
I was a student then, and at last I was down to play the Glazunov concerto. I was longing to play a concerto. And I wanted, however, as I didn't feel at all sure of myself, I wanted to get the best of the student conductors I could. It was with the second orchestra at the Royal College of Music. And so I asked who was the best conductor in the conducting class. And everybody I asked unhesitatingly said, "Ask Reginald Goodall." I can remember then how he looked. very neat and a little bow tie he wore. And I asked him if he'd like to do it. And so he thought a moment and he said, yes, on one condition, and that is that you give me 12 rehearsals before we do anything with the orchestra.
Our quest led us next to a Victorian church in central London. Here, Bruckner's Te Deum received its first ever performance in Britain under the baton of Reginald Goodall. St. Albans, near High Holborn, is very high Anglican. Badly bombed in the war, it's blessed with a fine tradition for church music and for ritual. Reginald Goodall himself had converted to Catholicism, and he found the place congenial, particularly as his musical studies in Vienna had given him a taste for the masses of Haydn and Schubert and indeed Bruckner, which he conducted here on feast days, as well as performing his regular duties as choirmaster and organist.
I think the thing that Goodall did was to give a tremendous lift to the sort of standard that we had here. And when he left in 36, the parish magazine glows with the sorts of things that the vicar said about him, and I think there'd been a real difference. He'd introduced modern music, he'd introduced a series of concerts, he performed Bruckner, who was almost unheard of then here in England, and in every way gave a tradition that we've been able to plug into now in the post-war period.
There was even a plan, pre-war, for EMI to make a commercial recording here. It would have been a real collector's item. One of the boy choristers in Mr. Goodall's choir has become a lifelong friend, Wilfred Stith.
He's always had this element of genius as a conductor. He was always able to produce, to get out of people something which they didn't know they had in them.
And you know that because you were singing with him.
That's right. And he did it with us, we knew here in this church. And people came from a long way to hear what I always regard as performances in this church rather than Sunday services, actually.
The congregation was more of an audience.
The congregation was an audience, really. And they didn't breathe when we were singing, I can tell you.
Mr. Goodall held rehearsals 4 times a week. What was he like?
Oh, dynamic. Absolutely dynamic. A musical volcano, absolutely, which still exists today, I may say, but it doesn't erupt so often.
In 1936, Reggie got his first job at Covent Garden, not conducting yet, but working for famous conductors like Albert Coates. He also did freelance work as an organist and as a chorus master, sometimes assisting Dr. Malcolm Sargent. And he travelled abroad as the accompanist for a German lieder singer. His profound love of German art must have made the 1939 war even more difficult to accept.
And the war meant an end to all his conducting work, except here at a Kensington church, where for several years Reggie had been running a weekly rehearsal orchestra in the church hall. No public, just musicians.
Then he was invited down to Bournemouth, where the local council had just disbanded its fine municipal orchestra. The unemployed players and some stalwart local ladies refused to let it die. And here Maisie Aldridge, who comes from those parts, takes up the story, because this is her scrapbook.
I rang up Reggie and said, would you like to come down and conduct at Bournemouth, do a concert? I never forget the opening. They did the overture of Figaro at the right speed and at the right spirit, and the concert went on like that. Although it was a small orchestra and limited resources, but it was a true music straight away. Naturally, he didn't want any performance interrupted for air raid warnings. So we got somebody to walk across in front of the platform, you see, and carry a large cardboard placard that said, air raid in progress. And leave if you want to, but I never remember anybody leaving.
Many famous soloists came down to Bournemouth to perform with Reginald Goodall at these weekly concerts, including the Nightingale-inspiring cellist Beatrice Harrison.
She'd been playing the Elgar with Dr. Sargent up in Liverpool, and she said to me, you know, Sargent does it extremely well, and I thoroughly enjoyed it, but nothing to the way that Reggie Goodall does it.
In Bournemouth, Reggie had learnt the conductor's trade. But in 1942, he was called up, and there followed a black year with no music and much misery. Here our quest led to the BBC's own file on Reginald Goodall. Nothing sinister, simply the record of contracts and memoranda. The very first letter, October 1943, is to the BBC's director of music, Sir Adrian Bolt.
I'm writing to ask if the BBC would be able to use my services as conductor.
The BBC replied by saying it would attend one of his concerts to form its own judgment. A few weeks later, Reggie wrote again.
Since my return from the army, I found it impossible to obtain a single conducting engagement, so I'm unable to let you know when, if ever, I shall be conducting next. Yours sincerely, Reginald Goodall.
But there was light at the end of the tunnel, and it came from Joan Cross the soprano, Ellen Orford in the original Peter Grimes. During the war, she was director of Sadler's Wells Opera.
I don't remember anything. That is my trouble nowadays. I have no recall. Yes, I sort of remember. And I have a feeling that I did a couple of arias with him in Bournemouth or somewhere like that, and I'm quite sure that one of them was Butterfly. The aria. And I can't believe that that interested Reggie at all. You do realise, don't you, that I got Reggie involved in the wartime company. And he and Collingwood went up and down the country, you know, literally hundreds of miles, weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks, conducting all the operas they least wanted to conduct.
Collingwood is Lawrence Collingwood.
Lawrence Collingwood, yes.
And so Reggie was in the war, in the pit, with big symphony orchestras or scratch orchestras?
You must be joking. Scratch orchestras, very, very ad hoc.
But in 1945, the company moved back to its old London home. And wonder of wonders, Reginald Goodall was chosen to conduct the hugely important premiere of Benjamin Britten's new opera, Peter Grimes.
I always think of Peter Grimes as the sort of, you know, climax of opera from the rather dull, ordinary things that we were doing, like repertory we'd done up to Rosenkavalier, Valkyrie, and that sort of thing. And then suddenly Peter Grimes appeared, and that seemed to be a sort of huge stepping stone, didn't it?
To beat and call heaven upon me.
I'm sure he would have been just sticking his nose in the score. I mean, he was a real studier. He was intensely serious about it. He admired it greatly. And let me say here and now that I think his performance of Peter Grimes was far and away the greatest that I've ever seen or taken part in. It was absolutely
greater than
super.
The composer's own performance?
Yes.
What was the measure of the greatness?
Well, partly because Reggie, all then, was a professional conductor, whereas Ben was a composer-conductor. Ben was absolutely delighted with Reggie. One of his great qualities, that concentration on what was being done. Right. And it was that that came into the performance of his Grimes, Peter Grimes. That second act, Manhunt, was unbearably touching and exciting and appalling in the way he did it. And again, I say, it's never been done like that.
The Manhunt is one of the most terrifying pieces in all music, isn't it?
Well, I thought so.
And do you think Goodall had some special sympathy with that?
I think he did, I do. I think that, without putting too fine a point on it, I think he had, in a way, a chip on his shoulder, whatever that may mean.
Even then?
Yes.
Even though he was a conductor of the best opera to have emerged for centuries?
Well, yes, one can have different shaped chips, can't one? And I think that he was very aware of certain disadvantages in himself. And I think he'd been aware of his own character as it then was, he was painfully shy. Okay, shy, but why be painfully shy? Mm. And retiring. And one can't imagine how he would have coped with certain situations except by silence.
It's extraordinary the man of that reticence can nevertheless dominate an orchestra and a chorus.
Yes, well, sir.
How did he do it? How did he make the
Well, by force of character and force of musicianship. And also, I think, by the intensity which is electrifying when he's there in the pit. It's silent electricity, because I don't think he shouts to an orchestra. I don't remember him shouting ever in those days, and I don't suppose he does now.
Yet you understood me fully. I warned of my rage.
If you fail, bitter.
In 1946, Reginald Goodall and Joan Cross were in at the beginning of a new operatic venture, following a bitter row at Sadler's Wells.
I left because there was this terrible schmuzzle about Peter Grimes, and Peter, Ben and I felt we really had enough of it. And that was the beginning of the English opera group, you see, because Ben was saddened by the attitude of the chorus, mostly, who didn't like his music. They found it difficult and they had no faith in it. And this, I think, used to rile Reggie pretty much. He couldn't understand anybody not understanding Ben's music, because he had total understanding of it, I think.
See how lust hides itself. It stands like a sentinel, then moves with stealth. The pity is that sin has so much grace. It moves like virtue. Back, Tarquinius!
And now our quest leads us to one of the most influential figures of post-war British opera, the Earl of Harwood, an early admirer of Benjamin Britten's operas.
I went about half a dozen times in those early performances. I fell totally for the Rape of Lucretia and the magic of that chamber orchestra and those good surroundings and a lovely cast. And I certainly remember Reggie conducting it then.
It must have been a great sadness to find Reginald Goodall moving away from the centre of things. Perhaps you weren't aware of it at that time.
Well, no, because almost immediately after that he moved to Covent Garden, and that looked to be very much the centre of things. And he had a great deal of conducting there. Not always on the most exalted level, shall we say. I think he would be the first to say it. And in retrospect, of course, a rather badly chosen repertory. He did conduct Grimes there early on, but he conducted a great many Traviatas and Trovatorias, and he didn't like them. And that probably showed. One didn't know that, but it probably showed. But I remember David Webster saying, we must find something for Reg. He always referred to him as Reg for some reason. We must find something for Reg. What about Wozzeck? And I said, well, it's must be the right world for him. He said he doesn't like much of the Italian work, which he was asked to conduct. And I remember Reggie borrowed my recording of Wozzeck to see what he thought it sounded like with Metropolis. And it came back in a state that I now discover is habitual for recordings lent to Reggie, which was scarred.
Although Goodall did fine performances of Alban Berg's Wozzeck and Mussorgsky's Boris Godunov, it was Wagner's operas which held him most in thrall. In 1954, he conducted this music for the first time, the Walküre from Wagner's Ring Cycle, not at Covent Garden, but out of town, as they say, at the Davis Theatre, Croydon. Young music critic Andrew Porter covered the occasion for Opera magazine.
Overnight, with this performance, he placed himself in the forefront of our Wagnerian conductors. Mr. Goodall's conception is broad, warm, flowing, and profound. On the strength of this, he should certainly be offered the second ring at Covent Garden.
But he wasn't. Sir David Webster, the administrator at Covent Garden, did not take up the suggestion. Webster's successor is Sir John Tooley, who explains why Reginald Goodall was offered not more but less conducting as the years went by.
I think it was entirely due to the conditions and the provision of conditions which would enable Reggie to work to best advantage. I mean, here's an extraordinarily sensitive and musical man. I mean, I think one of the finest musicians this country has ever produced. But he does need certain conditions in which he can really flourish. I do not believe those conditions exist in an international opera house where singers arrive in good time for rehearsal, but not sufficient time for Reggie really to be able to work.
Why Webster treated him very badly. But at the same time, one has to look on the other side of the picture. It's a stupid world, music, you know. It's a stupid world.
But you,
it's
as a manager,
worse.
You,
it's worse than politics.
You know what the problems were as a manager yourself of rehearsal time. Reggie demanded a great deal of time. Webster perhaps couldn't provide that amount of time in a busy international opera house.
Rubbish.
At Covent Garden, he would have run up against all sorts of problems because he was he always has been a very demanding person, as you know, about rehearsals, about how he works with singers and with orchestras. I'm sure perhaps some of that was not totally acceptable in the establishment world.
But at the same time, if he got such wonderful performances as you've described, people would, I'd have thought, forgive him for his difficulties and his demands.
Ah, but you know, we never accept that sort of thing with our own people.
It's a prophet without honour.
That's right, yes. If he'd been Italian or if he'd been
Romanian.
German or Romanian, yes, he'd have got his conditions. In England, as with the name Reginald Goodall, who was going to give him those conditions?
There was a bit of bad luck for him there because Kubelik, who became music director around that time, was not by nature then, at least. He became it later, a Wagnerian. But Rudolf Kempe had come to conduct at Covent Garden, and he was the exact opposite, really, as a musician, Reggie. He was tremendously fluent, tremendous technique, very steeped in Wagner, like Reggie, but quite a different kind of Wagner, much quicker-footed. Style, you might say. He was too obviously the right man in the right place in a way to let in the less fluent Reggie. That was bad luck. Genuine, real bad luck.
Reggie's conducting work didn't increase when George Scholte was music director in the 60s.
I think it's fairly safe to say, because everybody knows it, that Scholte, who was musical director, didn't really admire him very much, didn't see the point of him, didn't expect one of his junior staff conductors to have all the rehearsal that Reggie likes to have, and so he didn't employ him very much. But I think there was a band of us, like Andrew Porter, Peter Hayworth, David Cairns and I, who all idolised Reggie and went to every performance of his that we could possibly get to.
In the 50s, might it be fair to say it was a scandal he wasn't doing more?
Oh, I don't think one can use words like scandal. I mean, you know, a music director must have his own policy of how he thinks his work has to go.
Harold Rosenthal was also on the staff at Covent Garden in the 1950s. What was his impression?
Always the same. A self-effacing, modest person who was much happier working in what I think many people have told you was called Valhalla, up in the upper part of the house with singers, rather than being in the pit and before the public.
So this extraordinary change had taken place in Reginald Goodall's career. He'd chosen to be in mainstream opera, but after many years of conducting here, he was being relegated, it would seem, to a tiny upstairs practice room behind the balcony bar. It's also used as the usherette's changing room in the evening. This is Valhalla, Reggie's home ground. It still is.
That's all the C-string you have.
Yes,
and they got a nice C-string.
Okay. Well, I came here in 68, never seen anything like it. Walked into the room, was due to do The Night Watchman in Reggie's Meister Singers at the Coliseum. And we played the introduction, and even before I opened my mouth, I was already wrong. And I think that really goes to show what his music's about. I mean, you can't even be wrong before you begin to sing. And
what was it he wanted you to do that you weren't doing?
Well, one wasn't poised to get out the way that he wanted, the delivery, the intensity, the idea.
Mm-hmm. mit der Glut. Umglühenden Fels.
It's all done by telepathy, and I don't think it's like music. You can't put it into words. I think the basic thing is that he looks at every bar, and whereas most conductors will do five works in a year, he'll do five works in 20 years. And he has an awful lot more time than most people, and he pours over every bar. There are many little things that you can say that he does that other conductors don't do. For instance, he's a great one for portamenti.
Slides.
If you like to call it slides, but it's moving the voice from one note to the next. And many conductors, if you start doing that in rehearsal, they'll no. And of course, it gets very dry. But with Reggie, you get this movement of the voice, and the singers, they don't bark any longer. They sing with a line.
Many years on from Donald McIntyre, Reginald Goodall is conducting and coaching a new Votan, the young Welsh baritone Philip John.
No change.
And
if you had been an average opera goer at any time before 1968, you probably wouldn't even have known the name Reginald Goodall. Even within the company, he was familiar, yet mysterious, almost a phantom of the opera.
One never got to know Reggie personally that well. He comes in and out of the theatre like a ghost. I've even sat in the stage door corner there and seen him drift out of the theatre. And no one on the stage door has seen him go. And people have come and inquired, or seen him come in, and people have come and inquired and said, is Reggie in? No, he's not in today. And I know he's been in it.
Reggie was then moved, some years later, to the usherette's cloakroom, which I think you've already seen, right up at the top. And when he first went there, it was fairly Spartan. And the window up above him, the great skylight above, didn't fit very well. We were up there one day and it started to snow, and he sat at the piano with snow drifting down past the end of his nose between him and the score.
Completely oblivious.
Oh, we never saw it at all. Never noticed.
On the day Omnibus visited the Royal Opera, a little gathering of Covent Garden veterans was organised.
Come on, Reggie, join the tea party.
This is just a little group of the people that you know, and we would love you to have a cup of tea with us. And this is the only way we can say thank you to you for many, many years. Mm-hmm. It's not often we see you in this house, you see. Therefore, we would like you, so sit down here, you know.
Reggie, dear Reggie.
Nobody told me about this.
No, we didn't intend. Dear Reggie, bless you.
Thank you for your lovely pupil.
Oh, thank you.
Sit down. Thank you. Give me a cup of tea. I'm a good waiter.
Most of us here are so grateful, Reggie, for the coaching with you in those early days, especially in the Wagner. Yeah. And you know, I remember the Valkyries all came to you to be coached. And I know when I came to learn my part, I'd be singing away, trying to memorize it, and Reggie would say, stop! Listen. And he'd play a diminished seventh, and he'd caress the keys, and pause and purr for about two or three minutes, and I used to think, oh, Reggie, get on, I want to learn my part, I shall never know it.
What about the early days?
I played off an hour. I've learned a lot of wisdom.
When we all worked with you in various places.
Oh, yes.
In this theatre where there was such a lack of rehearsal rooms, do you remember?
Yeah, bedroom box.
Bedroom box. Yes.
Great standby.
Yeah, and they put a loo in there now, haven't they? And
well, there always was a loo. Then,
was it?
With
oh, yes, that's true, yes, there was, yes.
It was a vintage one, it's probably a valuable
antique. So now we have some sort of picture of Reggie in his Covent Garden era. And having watched him at work and heard about him from his colleagues, it's time to meet him face to face, as it were, before we bring his story up to date with the Wagner triumphs of his wonderful Indian summer. To start with, the interview was rather hard going.
When did you decide to become a musician? When you were a boy?
No. My father was a musician. He didn't want me to become one. I just drifted into it.
But then I heard also that Sir Hugh Allen finally went to Canada to get you to come and be a student. Is that the right story?
Yeah.
Because he was a marvellous influence on so many musicians and guiding people's careers. You were at the Royal College when he was... Hmm? Was he principal of the Royal College when you were at a student there?
Was he what?
Hugh Allen. Was he in charge of the Royal College?
Yes, yes.
If you're drifting, you can't really drift into the Royal College. You've got to have some talent already, haven't you? So were you at that time thinking to be an organist or a conductor or a pianist or what?
Organist, I think. Pianist and organist.
But...
Companies.
It was a sticky start, and the conversation didn't pick up until I mentioned Benjamin Britten, 11 years younger than Reggie.
Well, he was at college when I was there, and I may have been introduced to him. And he showed me a little Te Deum he'd written, and wanted to know if my choir would like to do it. And I said yes, and we did it at an Iris LeMayer concert, which he had in Ladbroke Grove.
What was Ben like in those days?
Oh, charming boy, and he played viola for me in the
orchestra.
Yes.
The Royal College of Music may not have done as much as it should for Benjamin Britten, but it gave Reggie a chance to study conducting professionally. And by the 30s, he knew that conducting was his ultimate goal.
If you were a student at the college, you were allowed into the rehearsals, which I learnt a lot.
And so this really gave you the impetus towards conducting, did it? Studying. Who was the first and most important influence? Would that be Furtwängler?
Furtwängler. Well, it fascinated me. It was fluid, very involved in the music.
But an architectural design, a concept for
perhaps
music?
Not so much as tempera, but a very wide emotional.
When you're studying conducting, do you also study the physical body language which is involved? I mean, would you say that you consciously modelled yourself on one conductor rather than another?
No, I don't think one does that. I think one studies the interpretation of those, first of all.
But there are people who say that your technique does resemble Furtwängler's in the sense that it takes the last moment before you give the precise moment of attack, that the preparation is very lengthy of the beat.
Well, that evokes such a lovely sound and such a rich, warm sound that one, I suppose, can't copy it. I mean, his first concert here after the First World War, they did in the first, for the opening, the Prelude and Liebestod from Tristan. And it was so wonderful, the cello, in the very opening, and the chord delayed it slightly.
Ah, that's the point. You actually delay. That's a Viennese trait, isn't it? Anyway, the Austrians always take longer.
Some people don't like it. I mean, it holds up, but it builds up the tone. And that comes like a great wave over.
Now you travelled a lot before the war. You went to Salzburg and to Munich and to Vienna. You had, therefore, a certain amount of wherewithal. You were earning enough money, forgive me, for probing in this way.
Yes, I was, yes. I had small choirs and orchestras.
But clearly the German musical world was a place you had to visit. You had to get the flavour of it.
Yeah. Well, I was playing for Reinhold von Warlick, who was a very distinguished leader singer, and he had master classes, Schubert, Wolf, and some Brahms songs, which fascinated me.
So although you were already in your 30s, you were still very anxious to learn. And I suppose the whole of your life could be said to be a learning process. You've never stopped studying.
I'm 83, I've still got everything. I haven't got the end of Valkyrie right yet, but that may be because I'm stupid.
So let me understand, make sure I've got what you just said. You're 83 and you still haven't got the end of Valkyrie right.
No.
You conducted it 40 times.
Yeah. It shows a lack in me then.
people seem to be prepared to accept that lack and still come and listen, thank goodness. But your work is never over, is what you're saying. And you're constantly
I don't think anybody's is. I think we've all...
But in the late 30s, conducting work was very hard to come by, hence Reggie's rehearsal orchestra.
That was mostly students from the college and players. We'd play through all the symphonies of Beethoven, Brahms, Sibelius, and play a concerto. Any gifted young or any person had a solo, the Elgar violin concerto, we'd do it with them. We gave them the chance to play it, to try it out, and gave the players a chance of, and gave me the chance of learning the work as well.
When the 1939 war broke out, Reggie had no professional work at all, until, that is, the invitation came from the new orchestra in Bournemouth.
And I happened to meet the leader, or one of the leaders, in Chester, as it was, I remember, and he said, tell me what had happened, and said they were going to, just to keep themselves in, they were rehearsing and playing, would I come, because he'd played in my rehearsal orchestra, which I, would I come and conduct them, and he said, we can only pay you your fares down. I said, well, yes, I'll come down, anything, do something, some work. And we did two or three rehearsals, and some lady, they got one or two ladies who had some money, said they would put up money for them to give a concert in Christchurch, which they did, and it was, seemed to be successful. And then on we started slowly giving a concert a week, and then we did more. And finally we were touring all over England until I was called up, and the whole thing...
The whole thing stopped. The transition from respected and much-loved conductor to conscripted private soldier was brutal. I asked him if he felt he was helping to win the war.
No.
What did you have to do?
Clean out latrines and dig things, sweep up the...
Let me guess, you were in the Royal Army Service Corps?
Huh?
Were you in the Royal Army
no,
Service
I was
Corps?
No, what they call it? The
Pioneers?
No.
Doesn't matter, you were in a nasty part of the army.
Yeah.
Any chance to make music while you were in the army?
No, none.
You must have felt very wretched.
I did.
How did you manage to get out?
I think somebody told the colonel in charge about me being there, and he'd been to a concert that I had conducted before I was called in the army, and Sighton knew my name, and he called me in to see him, and I told him they'd thrown all my Mozart books that I'd gotten, on the floor, and that I felt that I wasn't a criminal, just because I was called up, why I should be treated like, you can't do this and can't do that, and he said, of course, Goodall, you shouldn't be here. I said, well, what can I do? He said, I'll see, I think he did something, I don't know.
And as we know, Reggie was discharged and went to work for Sadler's Wells, where he conducted Peter Grimes. It was broadcast live from the stage a few weeks after the premiere, so Reggie did get work from the BBC. After the army, Sadler's Wells had been like seventh heaven.
Benjamin Britten and Peter Pears were travelling with the company. Peter was singing, and Benjamin Britten was writing Grimes. In each town, Birmingham or Liverpool, an act would come along. And he knew me. And Honest Collingwood felt it should be conducted by a younger man than him. And he very kindly suggested me, Benjamin wanted me as well, because I'd done some of his works before. And they asked me if I would... conduct Grimes. And I said, well, if you think I can, I'm very glad to do.
Was it a tough assignment with a composer looking over your shoulder all the time?
Yes, but a very enhancing time. I mean, you could ask him about how does this go. And he's a wonderful pianist. He used to play, I said, Ben, play the first act for me this morning. He was saying, if I had a rehearsal in the afternoon, he'd have done up on the piano. Then you get the right tempo, the right feeling, the right mood. It was wonderful.
It must have been like...
One does anything for a creative artist, you know. I mean, one would do anything for Britain.
So Peter Pears told me that he thought your interpretation of Grimes remained supreme for him, particularly in the second act, he said, The Manhunt.
Yeah.
Do you remember anything special that would lead Peter to say that?
Well, it's a sort of progression which I'm very fond of. It sort of goes on and mounting, steigerungs.
I think I have.
Yeah. I hope you don't have the part from his price, right? And the big Grimes calls at the end.
When the chorus horse comes down to the front and shouts.
We time them exactly, each one a little longer, and each and dynamically to start at a different level of sonority, so that the last one became a. And there's also the producer, they stepped forward with each one, which gave a shattering effect. Britain had asked me to become music director of the English opera group, and which I was very glad to do. And I'd asked the theatre at that time to be absent during the 3 months in the summer.
The idea was for Glyndebourne and the English opera group to join forces.
Rudolf Bing, who was head of Glyndebourne at that time, said he wanted to see me before they took them on. And having had an interview with me, he decided I wasn't of sufficient weight and authority to become. And he thought they should have an international conductor, which they did, Ernest Onsame. And Britain had rather to accept. He could have said no, I suppose, and maybe lost Glyndebourne. But I was very happy to work with Onsame. I respect him very much. It didn't matter to me whether I was right or.
Number two.
Especially with number two to a man like Onsame.
And anyway, Reggie had become a conductor with the new opera company at Covent Garden under music director Karl Rankel. He's still on the staff 38 years later. I asked him if he'd come to regret the move.
Well, because I was already hearing and listening to people better than myself, which is very important. That's the way you learn. I liked working with Rankel. He was an excellent music director. Experience.
Yes, he came from the Austro-German world. Yes,
he knew how. He put in a wonderful repertory. He knew how to gauge singers.
I went on to ask why in the 50s and 60s Reggie hadn't pushed for a bigger conducting career.
Well, I don't think I'm a managerial type. I was happy to be at Covent Garden and learn from. We had people like Guilini there, Clemens Krauss, Eric Kleiber. I would rather listen to this, be there and assist them than be a big toad in a small puddle.
Even though you had conducted the premiere of Grimes and done other performances. That, yes. And also, would it be fair then to say that the whole period of your 20 years at the Royal Opera House was a kind of apprenticeship, a very long apprenticeship?
Yes.
Because many singers have paid tribute to the fact that although you weren't conducting in the pit, you were teaching them major roles. Did you see yourself in some way in your little private studios as the sort of fountainhead of understanding of the big parts?
Well, conductors were like Rankel,
Kempe, Kubelik.
No, Kubelik Kempe, and after them. Oh, Scholte wanted to would accept singers if you prepared them properly and put them in, give them a chance. And so I was very happy to work with singers up in the room there, and then see them like Donald McIntyre, David Ward, Gwyneth Jones, see them go on.
So that you were the ultimate in backroom boys.
Yes, backroom boys. Yes.
Hovering over Reggie all this time was his growing obsession with Wagner. And in 1968 comes what I think of as the miraculous moment in Reginald Goodall's career. The Sadler's Wells Opera, under Stephen Arlen and Edmund Tracy, amalgamates its two companies and invites Reggie to conduct them, on his own terms, in the Master Singers of Nuremberg.
It really was an extraordinary occasion, and I remember at the end of Act Two, which of course is a riotous act, as we know, but at the end of Act Two in Sadler's Wells, when it came back to the night watchman's call. There was absolute magic in the theatre. And I well remember coming out into the foyer, and nobody could speak. Nobody spoke at all. There was silence from the audience. All the hard-bitten critics and professionals and so on all gathered in the foyer for their coffee or their drinks, and people could not speak. It was an extraordinary moment.
I remember one evening, just hated the idea of the performance coming to an end. And when it was Act Three, I felt it had taken precisely 5 minutes. You just aren't in contact with the world.
Although there are those people who say that his performances at that time were on the slow side.
They may have been, but they delivered the music.
The ovation that he received from the audience before he began to conduct the beginning of the C major chord of Master Singers was tremendous. And I consider that to be almost a psychic experience, because he was virtually unknown. There were a few people who knew him, but I'm convinced that most of those people who were so enthusiastic about him before he'd even began had never seen him or heard of him before. He had already communicated something extraordinary. And in fact, I remember one of my colleagues at the Coliseum saying that they were very worried about that first night, because the rehearsal period had been very quiet and withdrawn, and they knew that he had something tremendous, but they didn't know if it was going to come out, and it came out even before he started.
I had never heard any of his work before, and I remember I was standing upstairs, and I can remember the very first chord of the overture, because it struck me straight away that this was something so different from the normal type of attack in the sound that I was used to in modern performances of that time. It came from the bass upwards, and Reginald Goodall, after all, was a double bass player. And instead of being a hard attack, it was a warm, rounded coming together of the chord of C major.
How had Reggie persuaded the powers that be to give him all the time he needed?
Well, Stephen Arlen and Edmund Tracy were both very much for it, and they realised that it needed it. I mean, I'd been in opera then for 25, 30 years. I'm not a fool. I wouldn't ask for 20 rehearsals if 10 would do. But...
And so did you feel that, in a sense, your time had come, that recognition, which had previously been held back, was now with you?
No, I didn't. I just felt it was an opportunity to do.
Is it really difficult for people to provide the kind of facilities, the kind of timing that Goodall demands, the sectional rehearsals, the coaching? I mean, it's a 2-year cycle, isn't it, just to get one opera on the stage with Reggie?
I wouldn't say it was difficult. I would say it was nearly impossible. He did, as you imply, he rehearsed for a very, very long while. He broke, in a sense, all the rules. There were more sectionals. There was more time devoted to singers' rehearsals. He was able to build up from one year to another. Not a simple process. People don't like rehearsing under this year's contract, next year's work. But they would do it for him. As a small example, when I arrived here in 1972, I was looking through the casting of the following season and said, what's happened to Alberto, Alberto Remedios? Why can't he sing whatever it was early on, Carmen or something? Oh, he's not singing anything before Siegfried, I was told. Siegfried was in, I think, February 73. The season was starting in August 72. And I said, but why not? He said, oh, because he's going to be coached entirely on Siegfried for the whole of the first 6 months of the season. And he was. And he has said to me since that he nearly went mad with the coaching then. He longed to sing something that was kind of easier, that was already in his repertoire, which he could just go out and do. But he didn't sing anything. So when it came to the first night of Siegfried, there was such pent-up energy and such knowledge of Siegfried that the long period of waiting did pay off.
The Ring cycle at the English National Opera, four enormous operas all conducted and coached by Reginald Goodall, is probably the most important purely British achievement in the history of opera in Britain. And thanks to their best-selling recordings, the whole world can now enjoy the mastery of Goodall's Wagnerian concept. And now, a decade later, Reggie has returned to the ring, this time with the Welsh National Opera in Cardiff. And here we near the end of our quest for Reginald Goodall, watching him at work on the Valkyrie. This is a production rehearsal. They're doing the end of Act Two and the death of Siegfried, sung by the young American Warren Ellsworth. The myth is what some people admire most in Wagner. I asked Reggie how important Wagner's stories are to him.
Well, I think he deals with life and the world as we know it. I'm not really a religious man, but I hold religion. I think it's necessary in life. And I think he deals with the fundamental, basic things of life. The Ring is finally about love. Without love, the world stops. The Meistersinger is about we must learn to renounce for somebody's happiness. We must have the strength to renounce. The rules are necessary, but emotion necessary. The two must be...
What would you say Tristan was about?
I don't know.
Although you've conducted it a good deal, haven't you? It's about so many... It's about love in a way, isn't it?
I suppose it is in a way, yes.
And Parsifal?
That I don't know.
So yes,
I have my own, but I can't put into words.
I'm in the same
Father,
paper.
Tell me, what
you
is it?
Go on.
For your daughter is filled with dismay. Oh, trust in me, dear. You know I'm true.
That's good, that's it.
Brunhilde begs you.
Not too much of that. In Hilda
begs you.
It's the Brunhilde.
Is it?
It's the Brunhilde.
Hilda begs you.
Is that right?
That's better, isn't it?
Yeah.
You didn't want a crescendo on C.
No.
Did I do one?
C.
C. Brunhilde begs you.
The Swedish director, Göran Järvefelt, is doing the entire ring for the Welsh National.
Do what you do.
Okay.
This is very good. And
with her, this is his rehearsal, but Reggie comes to everything.
Do you want the tone on Who Are You? Say you're sort of a cloudy sound.
No, I want the words to come. Who are you? Yes. This figure appears. Say.
She's not dead.
It was a little nebulous.
I see. Let me try it again.
Wagner said to look at her, so he shows he wants a certain sort of...
Are you safe?
Yes, I think that, dear. Don't you? I mean, I think...
Whatever you say.
For a true Wagnerian, such as Reggie, Wagner's own opera house at Bayreuth is the shrine. He went as soon as it reopened after the war.
And what did you feel when you saw the first opera there? What was it, Parsifal?
Parsifal. I was overwhelmed. The beauty of the scenic and stage, the beauty of the sound of the music, Knappes, Fuchs, and Biel, Wagner produced. After our tawdry years of arid, dreary English production, it was like a heaven opening up.
Wagner productions pre-war may have been awful, but thanks in no small part to Reggie's vision, British productions of Wagner, and above all British Wagner singers, are now often among the world's best.
Oh,
better.
Oh, dear?
I thought my Hollier to Hose were better.
Yes, they were. The last one was good, except you missed the toe. Hiya toe! You missed
I thought we were going hiya ha. That's what I did. I thought that's what we were doing.
Well, you do what's written, dear.
We don't always do what's written.
No, but...
Is it hiya toho? I went on purpose. Hiya ha.
No, it's your hiya.
Hoya toho.
No, there's no trying. Hoya ho. It's
hoya ho.
That's very free, too, you know.
No wonder I was wrong. I thought it was something different.
Am I right then in thinking that what you've done with your orchestral conducting in the ring is to make every player play like a chamber music player as an individual rather than as a band?
That's what I like to do because I find the orchestral players are very intelligent. A lot of them have their full scores by their side and they know more than you do yourself quite often, which isn't much perhaps,
But I've heard it said that you, for bedtime reading, will read the second clarinet part of the Valkyrie before you go to sleep. Is that true or false?
As that, but...
I've also heard it said that you've had a three-hour rehearsal session, a sectional rehearsal, with a triangle player. True or false?
No, that's just making a joke.
At the end of our meeting, I asked Reggie to tell me what meant most to him in life.
I was very blessed with a happy married life for 48. I would say that was the most important thing.
For 48 years, did you say?
Yes, something like that. I was 32.
Yes.
And after that, I would say music. I think we're grumble about in life. I think, you know, I think one mustn't demand too much of life.
Well, if I'd come to you in 1956 and said, Reginald Goodall, you're a happy man, wouldn't you have said, I've got something to grumble about, I'm stuck up here in Valhalla, while other people
are conducting
the ring.
Oh, that's only a small thing, yes, I don't mind that. That's only... I think you've got 3 square meals a day and a roof over your head. That's all you can demand of life, and everything else is added to you. I think you must have some... that there's something beyond just eating your breakfast and getting on the tube. You must have in life, or try to have in life, some vision.
Thank you.
Communicating a vision of Wagner has been a life work for Reginald Goodall, and we thank him for it from the bottom of the heart. Two months ago, Reginald Goodall fell ill with acute appendicitis. He was obliged to cancel a concert performance of Parsifal, scheduled for the Edinburgh Festival. The good news is that the operation was successful, and Reggie will soon be back at work with the English National Opera, on Wagner, of course.